Hey everyone, this is Diego Martinez, and welcome once more to Tunes, a podcast about the songs we vibe to. As you know, this is a show where we explore the context and legacy of underrated music anthems with the testimony from the people at the very heart of the creative process. In this episode, we'll take a trip down memory lane to the sunny and funky 60s with singer and songwriter Harry Elston, as he looks back on the making of his million-selling single with the Friends of Distinction, 1969's Grazing in the Grass.
When I read comments, sometimes on Facebook or YouTube, most of it is the happiness and the, you know, the sun beaming down and all that kind of stuff. But then when you get to the musical part of it, a lot of people loved, you know, the horns. They loved the rock guitar. They liked the, I can dig it, he can dig it thing. They liked Jessica, sprack it to me, sugar, and that kind of thing. When Grazing came out, this was a different kind of a trip, I think, you know, in different elements, and the song had different changes in it that I think the musicians could appreciate.
These days, vocal harmony groups are pretty much an endangered species. But back in the tumultuous 60s, they were all the rage, dominating both the AM and FM airwaves with rich sounds that were an expansion of doo-wop, gospel, folk, and other R&B influences of the previous decade. On either side of the Atlantic, you could find various acts that provided some of the sweetest vocal masterpieces of that era. From the Beach Boys and the Mamas and Papas in the West Coast, to the Four Seasons and the Left Bank in the East. And don't forget the Bee Gees and the Zombies across the pond. One soulful quartet in particular, despite being one of the most vocally cohesive outfits of their time, has remained criminally forgotten in the sea of vocal-latent groups. Harry Elston, Floyd Butler, Jessica Cleaves, and Barbara Love formed the Friends of Distinction. And almost right away, they hit it out of the park with breezy California harmonies and crossover arrangements that were light years away from their direct competitors and, for lack of better words, highly distinct. From 1969 to 1971, they had a prolific run of five LPs that peaked within Billboard's albums chart and six singles, two of them certified gold. Their catalog has been covered by Isaac Hayes, The Gap Band, and Luther Vandross. And it has also served as inspiration in the form of samples for the likes of Rick Ross, Jay-Z, Talib Kweli, Kanye West, and Nas. The Friends' different backgrounds contributed to the band's overall sound. In the case of Harry Elston, it was the exposure to gifted family members and friends that displayed their talents in the comfort of his San Diego home. Those influences would later help him in impressing and later working with a rock and roll Hall of Famer.
We didn't have like a band or nothing like that. It's just, you know, aunts and uncles and cousins that could play by ear. Now, the only thing that we're going way, way back. It's like my dad, we lived in what they call Frontier Housing Project in San Diego. It was a government housing project, so it wasn't, you know, real, real, real bad because all types of people lived there. But they used to come to our house, some of the church members, and they would be playing and drinking beer. And I'm saying, what are they doing, you know? So that was a musical family thing that my dad, they used to practice at our home. Then, and after that, my musical career started up with a group called Cell Foster and the Audios out of San Diego. And Johnny Otis came to now you too young. You ever heard of Johnny Otis?
Been looking for you, Daddy.
He would come to San Diego and have talent shows. And we won the talent show and we signed to his record label and we recorded three or four songs for Johnny Otis on his label.
Was
I didn't see Johnny that much, you know, of course, on stage and stuff like that. But Jackie Kelso and other musicians who produced us, I was, you know, when we were in the studio, I would see them. But Johnny was, he was definitely an influence. Johnny was big time, you know, and he gave a lot of black people, you know, starts. And that was great. Johnny was a good man. That's where I got my start, basically music, doo-wopping in San Diego. I was exposed to all kinds of music. I listened to all types of music. My vocal group was the Four Freshmen. And there was a tenor in the group. His name was Ross Barber. And I admired him very, very much. And I finally got a chance to see them and meet them. We were on tour in the same city one day. But I would listen to every Nat King Cole, Ray Charles, Little Richard, Perry Como. I listened to all of that stuff. So I would have a variety of music going on in my head.
Following a brief stint in the Air Force in Northern California, Harry went back south to L.A. and discovered there were people as passionate about doo-wop and jazz as he was. At a local party, he met one of these people, a suave, tall photographer by the name of Lamont McLemore, with whom he formed a group called the Hi-Fis. Other members included future Friends of Distinction singer Floyd Butler and beauty queen Marilyn McCoo.
We used to go to a lot of parties in L.A. You know, we were in the mix. And like Dick Griffey, he's one of the boys. And Lamont, of course. Marilyn, you know. And we had this group. This group was called the Hi-Fis. You would recognize Marilyn and Lamont, you know, from that group. And then Floyd was in the group. Floyd took Lamont's place. And that's when we got with Ray Charles. And that was an experience right there. But that's the time I met Lamont. We were at a party, doo-wopping, and he said, "Man, we sound pretty good." He said, "Why don't you come by the house sometime?" And he gave me his address, and I popped on by there, and that's where the nucleus of the Friends of Distinction, the Fifth Dimension, the Hi-Fis, that's where we all got started, right there, at a place called Hobo Flats on 46 and Bud Long in Los Angeles, California. I remember that. With the initial groups, we would do doo-wop and, you know, popular song. But then the Hi-Fis, and we were strictly jazz. We didn't sing nothing but jazz. We had six-part harmony and stuff like that. So we really had to know your stuff. And they had this place called the Adams West in Los Angeles. It eventually turned into the Kabuki Theater. And people would come to town. Jazz artists would come to L.A. and perform. You know, where the jazz workshop, or they would be at Hermosa Beach, or maybe Shelley's Manhole. But after those performances, they would all come and do a show at the Adams West. It started at 2 a.m. in the morning. So we were like a staple on that show, the Hi-Fis. And we would sing, you know, jazz. Oh, we see Miles Davis, John Coltrane, all those people. And we were just in awe. But we held our own because we were singing jazz. So that's how that got started.
After several singles that received limited airplay, the Hi-Fis caught the attention of the genius Ray Charles, who not only offered them a spot as an opening act to his concerts, but also signed them to his Tangerine label as The Vocals. Harry got to see a genius in action, and a man that was both playful to his friends and respectful to his colleagues.
He heard of us, and he called down for us to audition. And I'll never forget this day. We walk into the studio, and all these musicians and stuff, I'm like, wow, you know? And then here come Mr. Ray Charles, and he was in his prime. So he liked us, he respected us, and we got along great. And we did some background for Margie Hendrix, you know, the Ray Les. We did some background for her. And Floyd and Ray did some duets together. They're in the can somewhere, but Ray, we were cool with Ray. We were with him for a minute. When we got with Ray Charles, he changed the name. We recorded on his label called Tangerine, and Ray changed our name from the Hi-Fis to the Vocals. And we would be on tour with Ray and open the show for Ray. I learned how to treat musicians, fellow musicians, because see, Ray had his plane. It's called the Buzzard. It was very well organized. And you had top-notch musicians on there. You had your assigned seat on the plane. Ray had his assigned seat in the cockpit. And it ran pretty smooth. The plane was called the Buzzard. We didn't crash. we had two experiences. One was kind of shaky. In Pittsburgh, we were taking off, coming back to LA, and the plane got airborne, and it came down. And we got out of the plane, we looked down, there was a big gully, big 100 feet. And then one time, we're flying into Knoxville, Tennessee, and I'm just looking at the engine, and it landed, and something happened in the bottom, and all the oil ran out. So they say, had this happened in the air, we'd have crashed, you know. But hey, that was quite an experience. Mr. Charles taught us a lot, and the musicians in the band taught us a lot also.
Much was accomplished during this time, but all good things must come to an end. So effectively did the vocals, who drifted apart due to so-called internal musical differences.
The split, you know, man, when you're young and you can get kind of cocky and put demands on other people that they couldn't, you know, live up to sometimes. But what you had to learn what an individual was bringing to the group, you know, knowledge, voice, choreography, personality, all that stuff adds up, especially in a group situation. Now, if you're by yourself, it's on you. But so we had a little musical differences. We had a leader. His name was Rex Middleton. Actually, he had a Rex Middleton in the Hi-Fi's group back in the day. But he met us, and he was older than us, but he taught us. Set six-part harmony. He was a genius. And then we had a gentleman by the name of Clarence McDonald. He was our musical director. We just learned, at least I did, and I could carry it over to the Friends of Distinction, like I told you, you know, about what a person brought to the mix, brought to the table. And you have to realize, you know, some people are stronger in one area, and then some people are stronger in another area. I learned that. But what I learned was just a group concept, a group look, costuming, dancing, who could sing this, who could sing that. So when we got to the Friends of Distinction, it was kind of laid out. Floyd and I kind of knew what we wanted to do.
While Marilyn McCoo and Lamont McLemore went on to become members of the Grammy Award-winning quintet, The Fifth Dimension, Harry and Floyd Butler set out to form a group of their own and auditioned several local singers. Two of them stood out during this period. Barbara Jean Love, a former acquaintance of Harry, and then 17-year-old high school graduate, Jessica Cleaves. Harry says he could feel the chemistry from the very beginning, and that their sound placed them apart from the rest of the vocal groups around, including his friends of the Fifth Dimension.
I was working for Continental Airlines in the air freight department. I had known Barbara from before. I didn't know her that well. I knew her and her sister and stuff. Like, we used to play cards and stuff at parties and stuff. So I knew her. I didn't even know she could sing, okay? So Barbara comes into the mix. Floyd was working for the Urban League in South Central LA, and Jessica came in. She had just graduated from high school, and she was looking for a job. And they had a conversation, and she told him she sang, blah, 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 blah. So we said, okay, well, let's check this out. So Barbara and Jessica and Ford and I, we did, you know, kind of gel. And then, but see, Jessica knew Jerry Peters and Anita Perrin, Greg Perrin, David Crawford. They had a loop thing going, like the Motown thing, but nobody knew them. But Jessica brought them on into the mix, and they had songs like Going in Circles and stuff. I Really Hope You Do. That came a little bit later. But when she brought them into the mix, our rehearsals went great. I came up with the name Distinctive Friends. And we you know, toyed with it for a minute. And then Barbara said, well, no, why don't we say Friends of Distinction? Bam, that just made a whole lot of sense. So that's how that came about. Distinctive Friends was the first hit, and then Friends of Distinction was the second hit. And it lasted all these years. I think, it's like the jazz background that we had, I think that made us a little different from a lot of the groups. Like we did songs like People, Didn't We? Classics, you know, and Barbara did Didn't We, and Jessica did the other song, and it would put us in another classical category. Then we did Eli's Coming, that put us in another category. Then we did some R&B stuff, Ain't No Woman Like the One I Got, and Eli's Coming and stuff like that. So we tried to do a variety of music. Now, what made us different from the Fifth, a lot of people say we were just more funkier than the Fifth. You know? But the Fifth could get funky too with Billy and all them. But hey, that's just the audience, you know.
Newly christened as the Friends of Distinction, the foursome was trying to get its act off the ground, but they needed the right person to pull for them. Enter American football legend Jim Brown.
Faster than a speeding bullet. More powerful than a locomotive. Able to leap tall buildings in a single bound. The pro game in the pop age had a number of superstars, but only one Superman, and he was Jim Brown.
Considered as the greatest back of all time, Brown shattered records during his 9 seasons playing for the Cleveland Browns. When he was just 30 years old in 1966, at the peak of his powers, Jim retired from the NFL and focused his attention on a film career. By the time Brown got together with Harry Elston and the Friends of Distinction, he had starred in a series of high-budget movies for MGM, including The Dirty Dozen, Dark of the Sun, and Eye Station Zebra.
I had a roommate. His name was Booker Griffin. Booker was into politics. Booker also was a disc jockey on KGFJ radio. He knew Jim Brown from Cleveland. So when Jim came out to play ball and stuff, he introduced us to Jim. Now, there was this beauty pageant called Miss Bronze California. Lamont was a photographer for the beauty pageant. One of our good friends, Howard Moorhead, was a producer, and Belva Davis and this beauty pageant has been going on for a few years. It was very popular. You know, you had Northern California, just black girls. So Jim being a star and a player, still playing ball and stuff, so he fell right when he came by our house, and we shooting pictures of them, you know, them girls in the center, Jet Centerfold and all that kind of stuff. He loved that, you know. One day he asked me, well, what are you doing? What are you trying to do? And I said, well, I'm putting this group together, blah, blah, blah. He said, well, you get it together and I'll come by and see you. So we rehearsed, and he brought Bill Russell by a bit with him. I said, oh my gosh, Bill Russell and Jim Brown, you know. So he liked what he heard, and we hooked it up. He became our manager. He had a company called the BBC, which stood for Brown, Black, and Covey. And these were people who managed him. So, you know, we just had the remnants. You know, we break wind and we're on TV, you know. So it wasn't bad at all.
As their manager, Jim Brown believed in the Friends' potential and knew he could flex his connections with the film and music industries to help them out. Although everything was not all that smooth, especially between him and Harry.
You know, Jim being from Cleveland and seeing the OJs and all, you had a lot of groups to come out of Ohio, the badass groups, you know, could play. So Jim had his, his thoughts, you know, in terms of music and what he liked and what he didn't like. And he never infringed on our music and stuff. Now, he might have said something to the record company, I like this, I don't know, but he let us do what we had to do. He could envision the look. See, Jessica was like 17 and stuff. And they were both attracted. So again, players and ex-players, you know that. So I think that's what he saw, the look. And then maybe he saw something that Floyd and I had, some leadership ability. And I don't want to get it. Everything wasn't peaches and cream, okay? me and Jim actually had a physical fight, okay? That's another whole story. We were in back of Maverick's flat, and we were racing. We were sports enthusiasts and stuff like that. And we used to hang in Maverick's in the daytime and then come back at night. But this time we were racing, foot racing, 50-yard dash. We were betting $10. Now, $10 back in them days, it wasn't, you know, you just wasn't no slouch, you did. So we were racing, and I never forget, I had on a Mickey Mouse T-shirt. And I thought I won by that much, you know. And this other guy said, hey, man, who won the race? And Harry, I don't want to get into it. I said, man, it's okay. Who won the race? He said, well, Harry, I think you did. And Jim, no, he didn't win. But I said, okay, take the money. And I just took the $10 and I threw it. And I hit him in the face or the chest or something. He reached out, picked up the money, and then he grabbed me. I said, you're choking me, brother. I'm pissed off now. You know, I'm snot coming out of my nose, tears. And so he let me go. I said, let me go. So Jim let me go. He said, well, you're going to get your gun now. You're going to shoot me, huh? I said, no. But I'm glad I didn't carry no gun. I wasn't into that. But I was pissed off and embarrassed and snotty-nosed and plus $10. So I hopped in my little ride and I went home. And I was towel around my neck, soaking my neck. There was a knock on the door. It was Jim. Hey, man, I'm sorry, blah, 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 blah. So we were cool, you know. what am I going to do, you know what I'm saying? But that was our fight. That was our fight.
Once everything went back to normal, the Friends of Distinction worked up an act for a showcase concert Jim Brown set up at an exclusive Beverly Hills nightclub called The Daisy, home to the cream of the crop of Hollywood's elite. It was the perfect launching platform the band had been dreaming of.
The Daisy was a badass club, okay, Beverly Hills. We didn't know too much about it, but Jim used to hang there with Frank Sinatra and Dean Martin, all those cats. But he set up a showcase there. We didn't know what a showcase was. So we got up and we sang, you know, did a showcase. We sang Grazing in the Grass. I remember that. I don't remember the rest of the songs. But evidently, you know, the reaction, that must have been cool, because the next day I had to see like 6 record companies. And I said, what the hell? And Floyd, I don't know why Floyd wasn't with me. But anyway, we auditioned there at the Daisy. And the next day we had to talk to record companies. And a few days later, we signed with RCA Records. You know, we were young. We were, and we didn't know the intricacies of the record company. So we just kind of put it in their hands. And when Jerry and them came up with other songs, everybody loved them. We had a new producer, Brand. His name was John Flores. He was out of Phoenix. He had an arranger, a friend of his named Ray Cork Jr. Ray, we never met until we went in the studio. And Ray arranged all that stuff for Going in Circles. And I Really Hope You Do, Eli's Coming. And Clarence McDonald. Clarence was on the scene. He was in the studio with us also doing our vocal stuff. I want to give Clarence... Because without Clarence McDonald, you know, we wouldn't have been nothing, you know, in the Hi-Fis and the Friends. And he helped Fifth Dimension, too. They knew Clarence very well also. RCA, I knew they had some big bucks, and I knew that was important. And with Jim's influence, and Jim was a hot property in the music, in the film industry also, that helped out tremendously. So they just opened those doors, and fortunately, we were ready. You know, because you know, a lot of doors open, people ain't ready, and they blow their opportunity.
Signed to RCA Records, the Friends of Distinction were ready to walk into the recording studio and work on their debut LP for the label. One of the first recorded songs for the album was a track that was already a part of their repertoire on their Daisy Showcase, and a popular song among audiences at the time. In 1968, South African trumpet player Hugh Masekela was recording his album called The Promise of a Future when he found out he was running 3 minutes short. Producer and former classmate Stuart Levine suggested they fill the gap by reworking a cowbell-heavy record called Mr. Bull No. 5, which Masekela had bought on a trip to Zambia. Thus, in less than an hour, Grazing in the Grass was born and became the LP's standout hit. Released as a single that year on the Uni label, the instrumental unexpectedly sold 4 million copies and reached number 1 on Billboard's Hot 100, where it stayed for 2 straight weeks. It also earned Masekela a Grammy nomination for Best Contemporary Pop Performance. Though African actor and musician Philemon Hugh was credited as a songwriter on the Masekela record, it was Harry Elston who penned lyrics to Grazing for the Friends of Distinction version, originally intended as Flaking in the Grass. Contrary to popular belief, it was not written in reference to any drug use. Instead, it was calling out something completely different, setting a scene centered in nature, laughter, and life.
We did a demo on Grazing in the Grass, and I didn't know that you could use the same name as the song. So I changed it from Grazing to Flaking in the Grass. We went and did a little demo. The demo was cool. They liked the demo, but they didn't. They said, no, what is Flaking in the Grass stuff? Get out of here. I said, really? I said, well, can we use Grazing? They said, sure. we just changed from flaking to grazing, and they loved it, and we went and recorded it. And we still didn't, we didn't know Grazing was gonna be the song. We didn't know nothing. So we just went and recorded, and the record company chose Grazing. And so, hey, you know, I was happy. So people would ask me, you talking about some weed? Well, you know, back then, you had to be cool. But then Floyd came up with this slogan. I think people should smoke what they want to smoke. So I just left it alone right there. Because you see, you had these young kids singing Grazing and stuff. And I didn't want to put that element. And people weren't ready for it anyway. They're more ready for it now. But I wasn't talking about no grass. Now, I'll tell you, the initial thought came when I would be on the road and I would see cows and horses and stuff just grazing and going to the bathroom. You know, that freaked me out. I said, Dad, all I do is eat and shit, you know. And so that element came out, you know, looking through the trees and all that kind of stuff. It's been such a long time. And I was 19, 20 years old or something like that. We had never heard their arrangement. Okay. We you know, bass and guitar and drums and blah, blah. That's what we had. But the day we went into the studio, now remember this, we're little rookies. I've been in the studio with Ray and Johnny Otis, but it's a whole other level. I walked in that studio, there was 100 musicians in there. We said, oh my gosh, you know? And we didn't know how it was gonna work. So all we did, we went in the little booth, all the musicians were out there. We saw Ray doing his work. I'd never seen Ray at work, you know? And he was firing it up, man. And after that, we said, oh, this is the arrangement. Everything here is so clear.
Thanks to the masterful production of John Flores, the arrangement of Ray Cork Jr., and the spirited performance of the Friends of Distinction, the vocal version of Grazing in the Grass became a massive hit when it was released in early 1969, reaching number 3 on the pop charts and number 5 on R&B. The group saw themselves in a whirlwind of promotion, which included concerts with Tom Jones and major television appearances on shows like The Hollywood Palace and The Ed Sullivan Show.
When I read comments, you know, sometimes on Facebook or YouTube, most of it is the happiness and the, you know, the sun beaming down and all that kind of stuff. But then when you get to the musical part of it, a lot of people loved, you know, the horns. They loved the rock guitar. They liked the I Can Dig It, He Can Dig It thing. They liked Jessica, rock it to me, sugar, and that kind of thing. So it's a lot of elements. And I think when Grazing came out, this was a different kind of a trip, I think. You know, in different elements, and the song had different changes in it that I think the musicians could appreciate. At some point, man, you're working so much, and you know, you got your itinerary here, and you say, nah, I had something. Say, oh, okay. And then you kind of get ready for it, you know. But at that particular time, it was just another show, you know, and hitting your mark and stuff. But on that show, it was Lucille Ball and Groucho Marx. So that was cool. I got a chance to just chat with them. It was cool. That was so great. Jim was there. You know, Jim did all the buffering that we needed. But doing those shows was great, man. There's a Flip Wilson show I just found the other day. Then there's a show called Black Omnibus. James Earl Jones is the host. And then I hadn't seen Floyd really perform going in circles in 15 years. But this one is just personal and it's up close. And it brought tears to my eyes.
The crossover success of Grazing in the Grass put the Friends of Distinction in a difficult position within RCA. Harry believes the label wasn't sure on how to properly promote the group on both its pop and R&B departments. Although they enjoyed other hit singles, including Grazing follow-up, Going in Circles, and 1970s Love or Let Me Be Lonely, featuring Barbara Love's replacement, Charlene Gibson, Elston says their label's interest waned after a while, and their fortune suffered because of it.
You you know, we knew we had something, but to what degree, you know, that's a whole nother thing. But see, that's where I learned about the value of a record company, and a record company having a department or departments that could zero in on this particular act, this particular genre, whatever. See what happened in RCA. RCA was a classical, you know, record label. In terms of black artists, you had Sam Cooke, you had Harry Belafonte, you had Charlie Pride in the country, and the Main Ingredient, New Birth, Jimmy Castor. You know, they didn't have a whole lot of black people. And then you had that R&B department. Well, I guess they called it R&B. But see, we were crossover. So you had the R&B department fighting for us over here, and the pop department fighting us over here. We were caught in the middle. And plus, we were traveling and performing so much, you know, that was another area, which we didn't know that much about. All we did was singing and picking up checks. They did pretty good to me initially, you know, because you had the record leading the way, and they did a hell of a job on Grazing in the Grass. We went on a 6-week promotional tour, then we were on the road with Tom Jones for 6 weeks. So they did their job. But now when they started bickering, different departments, and we come to New York and somebody take us to lunch over here, somebody take us to lunch over there. I mean, it should have been all good, you know, because it's promotion, but they dropped the ball in a couple of instances. You know, timely instances where, like that song, Love Could Make It Easier, that was it's a big album. And to me, it had some good songs on there, you know, like that song, Ain't No Woman Like the One I Got. You know, we said, oh, well, this is going to be a hit, blah, blah. The Four Tops put it out and crushed us. But the record company should have been aware of that, you know, anyway. But they to me, they did a good job initially. But at the end, I mean, I lived in New York for over a year doing that last album, and they didn't promote it for nothing.
The Friends of Distinction stayed with RCA until 1975, when the band officially called it quits. Harry tried to revive the group together with Floyd Butler in 1990. But Butler suffered a heart attack and died that year at the age of 52. Jessica Cleaves, who after the Friends split went on to sing for Earth, Wind & Fire and Funkadelic, died in 2014, aged 65, following complications from a stroke. Harry Elston did eventually revive the group with three other new singers, but has decided to retire from touring altogether, and has no plans of recording new music. Even though the original incarnation of the Friends of Distinction had a relatively short lifespan, their music, and especially Grazing in the Grass, remains such a vibe, memorable and timeless. The song's feel-good summer energy can be felt in commercials, animated shows like Family Guy, or movies like I'm Gonna Get You, Sucker. Through it all, Harry is content and proud with the fact that the Friends of Distinction were true friends who displayed a whole scope of sound beyond grazing, a sound that's appreciated by professional musicians and listeners alike, regardless of the season.
A lot of people just thought we just did grazing. And then people said, no. We did some, you know, going in circles, Lord, Let Me Be Lonely, I Really Hope You Do. See, we were blessed in this respect that, you know, when you're in a group, sometimes egos really get in the way. We didn't have that problem. I am so glad. I don't know. I guess I attribute that to Floyd and I. But if you think about it, Lover, Let Me Be Lonely, different, Charlene Gibson, Great Day, Barbara Love, Really Hope You Do, Jessica Cleaves, Going in Circles, Floyd, and Grazing in the Grass, Harry. So it's five different people. So when people came to sing with us, I said, hey, this is your song. This is your baby. You know, you take care of this and you learn this and blah, blah, blah. And they were thrilled to death, you know. And what it does, it makes the group look better because not one person is singing solo all the time. That helped. Being it's been such a long time ago, you have different, you know, you go through different moods. Somebody might say something to me, you know, some of the guys I played ball with, he said, man, I didn't know that was you, blah, 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 blah. And I felt kind of cool, you know, and because a lot of these guys grew up, they're younger, but they knew the music, you know, and because I played senior softball, you know that. But, hey, man, it's I feel honored. And then it's like, I know what happens. See, after you die, that's when all accolades and money and all that stuff comes. You see? And I know how that game goes, you know. But hey, I'm just proud that I am here and I can, whatever blessings are bestowed, I'm here to accept them as we speak. And I appreciate that.
Thanks to Harry Elston for his contributions to this episode. And thank you for listening. This episode was produced and hosted by yours truly, Diego Martinez. Our executive producer is Nicholas Nick Fresh Buzo. And our audio engineer is Adam Vogel. Follow Tunes all over social media, on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at ChoonsPod. That is ChoonsPod. Please rate us and give us a review on Apple Podcasts, as it will help other folks discover our content. And subscribe wherever you get your podcast. Join us next time as we take a deep dive into the legacy of songs you may or may not know on the next episode of Tunes.